my diehards, okay? I'm all about you guys. You're here on Saturday. We know how it goes, right? How it goes, like, so Thursday, Friday, they got off school. Okay, they're all cool with it. And then now it's weekend time, they're not gonna be here. And that's fine, okay? But this is where you gain the competitive advantage, just like we tell our players. Not that I have all the answers, but, you know, hopefully you can pick up on something that's gonna help your players. You know, this topic, the mental game, is anytime I used to hear someone start talking about the mental game, there was a part of me that was like, you know, okay, yeah, the mental game. You either got it or you don't, so, you know, why are we gonna spend all this time talking about this pie in the sky type stuff? That was kind of my gut feel on it, really. I don't know how you feel about it, but, you know, over time, being around different people, I've given it more credence. And I think part of why I give it more credence is we have found a way to kind of explain it better. When you can explain it better and people can hopefully understand it better, then you can tell somebody else about it, okay? Now you gotta be careful with the mental game because some people, they can't handle it, okay? Like certain players, just like when you're doing a drill, when you assess a player and they have a good foundation of skill sets, you're not gonna necessarily start them at the same place you would an 8-year-old who's never played infield. Okay, you gotta back up and start building to get them there. So in high school, you come across guys that are maybe you don't even wanna let them know that there is a mental side, because as soon as they start thinking there's a mental side, they start overanalyzing everything and they get in their own way, right? And then there's guys that are ready for it, okay? They're hungry for it. They can learn it, and it's not gonna become a roadblock for them. It's actually gonna be a catapult for them. It's gonna help them take their game to the highest level. Because truly, at some point, the mental game is the separator. It's the separator. It just is, okay? And if you don't believe that, I question your why. Like, why would you say that it's not? Because it is. Because at the highest level, you know, I play professionally, okay? We can all field, we can all throw, we can all hit, we can all run. I mean, it's like, so who's gonna play the best consistently? Okay, who's gonna use those tools the most consistently throughout the course of 160 games, 180 games, okay? 60 game, 50 game college season. You know, we played 30 games in the regular season in Georgia. Best of three every round in the state playoffs. I mean, we won state title, we were 39 games, and who's gonna be able to do that? It's the guys that mentally can get ready to play every day, not just every day, every pitch of every day, okay? Every practice of every day, of every, you know, the whole season, that kind of thing. So it's a big deal, and Nate Trosky, okay, and I have put this slideshow together for situations like this. He is a master teacher, and I was just talking to some guys outside that might be in here now. You know, your first impression when you see Nate Trosky is like, you know, who is this guy with a hat? He wears that straw hat sometimes outside, all the time outside, unless there's no sun. And who is this guy? He's like, is he a clown? I mean, who is he, you know? And if you listen to him for any sort of period of time, you begin to realize that not only does he know what he's talking about, but he knows extremely well what he's talking about. And I've grown more as a coach on the mental side in my time of knowing Nate Trosky. And I picked up more information from him than I have in all the clinics I've been to in 10 years. Like, he's that good, okay? Why would I stand up here bragging about Nate Trosky? He's become a dear friend of mine. We're business partners together, we do camps together. And a lot of this stuff is his. That's why. Okay? I want to give credit where credit is due. Okay? I'm hoping that some of this stuff will click with you. In fact, I know that some of the first things that we talk about are critically important to all of us. Okay? But then there's going to be some things that we get to in this slideshow, in this PowerPoint, where I'm talking a little bit about faith. Okay? And I don't want to lose people that aren't of faith, because it'll be when we're talking about confidence and how confidence is built. So if you don't believe in, you know, God, Jesus, a higher power, okay, if you don't believe that, don't let that lose you right there. Okay? You can have confidence in yourself. You can be self-reliant, okay? But you're not going to be nearly as confident being self-reliant when things start to crash and burn as if you have true faith. Okay? So just understand, you can have enough. There's big leaguers that don't believe in God, okay, that are at the highest level and have unbelievable confidence in their abilities to play. So I wanted to preface that for you, so when you get there, you don't like roll your eyes like, oh, okay, you know, here we go. So let's talk about this. I want you guys to participate with me on something, okay? You've seen this before, but I want to see how good you guys are at it, okay? I'm going to throw the ball up, and you guys know what's going to happen. You're going to clap, okay? As soon as the ball hits my hand, you're going to clap, okay? I may do it low, I may do it high. You've got to be on time with it with your hands, okay? So put your pens down, okay? Let's have a little fun. You've been sitting there for a while. Let's see how good you really are. You guys ready? Not bad. Louder. Slide step. Okay. High leg kick. Okay. High leg kick.
Oh!
Hang on.
Whoa.
I'm sorry. Ready? Okay. What happened right there? Here's what happened. You didn't know because I tricked you whether you were going to have to clap or not. You were not committed to clapping. You had a little voice of doubt inside of you going, I don't want to be showed up. I don't know if I have to clap or not. And you were not fully committed to executing the skill. That is exactly how the vast majority of your players play a baseball game. They are not committed. Okay, they're not committed to making pitches. They're not committed to the pitch when they're hitting at the plate. And they sure as heck don't know whether they're going to be able to field a ball when the game's on the line. Their body language may not say that, but that's what's going on in the space between the ears. Okay? They have a lot of voice of doubt. And you need to understand that we can get players to be as committed as you guys were when you knew every time I was going to catch the ball. Those are the guys, when they have a skill set to match, the physical skill sets to match, and they have the commitment that you guys had when you knew I was going to catch the ball, that take their game to the highest level. That's the simplest way I can define it to you, okay? You have to commit. So the first thing I try to do to my players that Nate and I do at camp is we actually want them to know how they are evaluated from a physical tool standpoint. You would be surprised how many of your players have no clue or just maybe a little clue as to how they're evaluated. How are you being evaluated by your high school coach? How are you being evaluated by the recruiting coordinator at a college? You want to play in college or a professional scout if you think you're professional. Okay? This is how you're graded on the five tools. Talk about a five-tool player. These are them. Hitting, okay? That's the guy that can barrel. We got a power guy, okay? Exit speed, reload, running speed, your run tool, fielding tool, throw tool. There's subcategories to these, okay? There's subcategories to them. Throwing, we have, you know, accuracy or command. Pitchers have movement, pitchability, all these kinds of things. But these are the five general tools that they're evaluating. Here's the grade that they're giving from Major League Scouts. These are the grades. So this is what they're marking on their little sheets. You hopefully don't want a 20. If you're a 20, you probably don't even need to be playing high school baseball, okay? But you can see 50 is average. We got plus, plus plus, which is well above average, and then you're elite. So If you get graded at 80s, you're like Hall of Fame status. You have the tool of the best players that have ever played the game for that category. So if you're running a 6.360 on lasers, you're an 80, okay? You're an 80. So we start to use this scale right here, not only to define the physical tools, okay, but we also use it to grade out the mental tools, okay, and that's where it starts to get really challenging. But I literally have standards that help my players. They literally got a sheet that had these things on it. I tell them how they're graded, and I had them grade themselves. Okay, I had them grade themselves. And my criteria for them was an 80 is the best high school player that ever played high school baseball. Okay, I didn't want them comparing themselves to major leaguers or college players. I just said, let's just scale this down to high school baseball only. Okay, and it was amazing. Some of them were extremely accurate, and some of them were like, had themselves way overrated. And that gave us some talking points. Okay, why do you think you're an 80, you know? You hit 240 last year, and you know, you only barrel up 3 out of 10 in BP, but you know, you're grading yourself as an 80. Okay, anyways, we gotta move forward or we'll get stuck. So this is the five tools. We're getting ready to talk about the sixth tool, which is the mental tool. Now here's the deal. We all know makeup, right? Makeup. We talk about a player's makeup. How important is a player's makeup? It's huge, right? It's huge. And you ask the coach, like, so define makeup. Define it. What is it? Grit, toughness, hunger as a player, they prepare, we throw out all these terms that are really hard to kind of package, okay? And you'll hear people say things like character, they have character, okay? Well, what you need to understand when you start talking about the sixth tool is character, okay, is something totally separate from makeup, okay? You can have one without the other. You can have a low character kid who has great makeup on the field, okay? Think about some of the major league guys that we look up to. They have great makeup, okay, on a baseball field, but like off the field, they have horrible character. So we really can't combine those two things together. What we're hoping is that we can create through coaching or help promote players who have both character and makeup, okay? And once they know where they stand and what those things look like, and then they can actually grade them, they now have a perception of what they want to be and how to get there. Like, where do I stand when I start to grade out? So this is one. This next one's 100% Nate's, okay? And I love it, okay? These are the five areas of makeup that make up the sixth tool. These are them, okay? You can literally define these out. We call the GDBRR. That's how my players, they know it. Like, tell me the six tools, what are they, guys? They'll go GDBRR, coach. What does G stand for? Grinder, they all say it. What is dirt bath? And what is D, dirt bath? B, bulldogs, R, rap, okay? So the grinder, you can read them with me, okay? This is a player who is present, focused, they are on time, one pitch at a time, they are grinders in the ball game. They are always present and focused. What's your grade? 20 to 80. Grade yourself, okay? So this is step two. I had them grade their physical tools. I hand them another sheet that has these on there. It has a little line next to each one. They gotta put their grade where they grade themselves, okay? Are you a 50? Are you average there? Are you below average? You a Hall of Famer? You're on time every pitch? You a grinder, okay? Dirtbag, high energy. There's a high energy guy, high intensity. Dirtbag brings the juice, okay? Their throttle is on, their octane is high, their light is green, okay? They are ready to go. These are your high energy guys. Grade yourself. Bulldog plays big with attitude, positive body language, not attitude like we use the word a lot of times, okay? Regardless of their size, strength, age, situation or circumstance. You can feel that, okay? They play big. These are your Bulldogs. Grade yourself. Your Rock. This is a big one. Strong from the inside out. Head strong, heart strong. Composure is even. Posture is big. Memory is short. Bounce back is quick. We call it a 12-second bounce back. That's all you got when you make a mistake. You got 12 seconds, and it's got to be gone at that point, okay? This is your Rock. And then your Rat. Nobody works harder than the Rat. These are the guys that are getting in every day in the weight room. They're staying late, coming early, putting in the work, whether you're there or not. Okay? So we're literally going to give out awards this year for each one of these, and then maybe an overall winner, because these are the things that I want to promote in my program. These are the things that create what?
Culture.
Okay? These are the things that create culture. You can have all the physical tools in the world, okay? But if you are low in these categories, I would say your ceiling is going to be nowhere close to what it should be if you have physical tools, okay? So when the players see these things, they can identify them. In fact, Nate is putting online, okay, on our website, he's putting online, he's created where, and he's made one for me, and literally the laminated, so we can use a dry erase, and every day when my guys come in, it's hanging on their locker, and they have to grade themselves in each of the six tool categories. How did you do? Okay? So it's amazing how much better they've come at it. So our goal is to be a 70 to 80. Okay? That's our goal. We want to live our lives from a character standpoint. You want to be a 70 to 80. Okay? We know that great infielders, you can put great players. Okay? You can put great people, great businessmen, great businesswomen. They prepare differently. Okay? They prepare differently. Their intent, their work ethic is at a high level. They're 70 to 80. Okay? They act differently, the way they carry themselves, the way they go about their business. At home, school, community, this has a lot to do with what? Character. Okay? They're 70 to 80 in the character. They play differently. They perform under pressure. They're the guys we all want on our team. I want 9 guys in my starting lineup that are like that, right? You're going to win a heck of a lot of ball games. Okay? They have consistency. So they think differently. They're mental makeup. They're 70 to 80. Okay? I don't know about you, but when Nate and I were talking about it for the first time, I was like, yes. Yes. And my players, they need to see this. And they need to understand it and embrace it. Okay? So now let's move into it a little bit. We all know the mind is powerful. We all know it's powerful. Okay? We all know about the different things that we can do with it, with our mind, but you need to understand just how powerful. There's no computer on the earth that's as powerful as the human mind. None. They're trying to create them that way, but they're not there. 40 visual images, thoughts per second, not just images, combination of images and thoughts per second. You can generate 23 watts of power with your brain. It's an electrical organ, okay? The mind creates thoughts. This is a big one to me. Creates thoughts, memories, concepts, reasoning, all by knowing what is real and what is imagined, okay? I got a few parents that doesn't define. But sometimes there's that gray area where, you know, you can actually trick your mind to do things positively, or they can actually hurt you, okay? Your mind, the way you think, can really, really hurt you. So can we get power over our minds? That's ultimate. So we talked a little bit about the space between. There's 15 to 20 seconds on average between each pitch. There's 6 inches between the ears. That is the space between, okay? When we learn to dominate the mental game in the space between our ears and between each pitch, that's when you become a giant baseball player. Okay, of course, never forget, you gotta have physical tools to go along with this. But what it's gonna do is it's gonna take wherever your tools are and it's gonna elevate your game, okay? The space between. So here's the faith part, okay? You can have self-reliance all you want. You can, listen, when I was a baseball player, I didn't have faith, okay? I didn't know anything about faith, okay? I was a self-reliant person. It was me, my goals, what I was gonna achieve. If I didn't do well. I mean, and there was a lot of voice of doubt. There was a lot of doubt that would creep around in my mind. This fear of failure, this doubt, am I good enough? Can I do it? You know, and day in and day out, it was like a new test, right? And I never really played with complete relaxation as a player, okay? Because the fear creates tension, just a little bit, okay? And when you're trying to be an elite player, we all know that when you're tense, you don't perform as well, right? Tight muscles are what? Slow muscles, okay? So when the brain is tense a little bit and you're mentally tight a little bit, you don't perform to your maximum potential, okay? When you have God, people who believe in faith, not only do they have themselves to have confidence in, but ultimately, when self starts to crumble, when I got released from professional baseball, when I didn't play well, and I was beating myself up because I wasn't perfect that night, nobody could see it, I was doing it inside my head, you know? Faith allows, this is where I feel like my son has a huge advantage on me, because he is a believer, and he plays for an audience of one. Like, to him, he ain't playing for the fans, he ain't playing for self-glory, all he's doing is just trying to glorify God. You might say, that's all pie in the sky, whatever, don't matter, I'm just telling you, that's how he thinks, and it's ultimate confidence comes when you actually believe that your abilities and your strength are centered in somebody other than yourself, okay? So when your self-reliance starts to crash, the guy that doesn't have faith, they're crashing. They have nobody to lean on or fall back on. But the person of faith, okay, they have that to fall back on. So it's ultimate confidence, okay? This is a scripture. A wise man built his house on a rock. Storms came, but did not fail, okay? Self-reliance, ultimately, sinking sand for most people, okay? Most people sinking sand. So, you know, fear. We need to understand fear because there's two things fighting for in our brain all day long, every day, every pitch, every game: confidence and fear. Those two things are battling for the forefront of your mind. They're going on. You're confident, you're a different player. Those of you that know Steve Springer with Quality at Bats, he says, you know, there's a really good player, the confident you, and there's the player that sucks, and that's unconfident you, right? So the enemy, okay, is the author of fear. He wants us to fear, not just in baseball, I mean, you know, but really in our lives. That's an unpleasing feeling triggered by the perception of danger, real or imagined, okay? Most of the danger that we believe is out there is just what? Most of it is imagined. We like fear and worry over things that never even happened the vast majority of the time, right? I mean, let's just think about our lives. I'm not even talking about baseball, okay? Disbelief, uncertainty, and doubt. Those are horrible words for a high-level elite baseball player, okay? They want to be on the other extreme. So the opposing forces, you see them, okay? They're fighting for the forefront of our mind. I talked about that. The question is, which one's going to win? The great thing is we have a choice. The beauty of the human mind is we have a choice. Which one of those two things wins every day, okay? Now again, it doesn't have to be necessarily confidence in God, but is confidence in yourself gonna win over your fear and doubt and uncertainty of whether you can perform, okay? Ultimately, that's what it is. But if you go down to the bottom, you see that being confident allows infielders to think big. And when you think big, when you think confidently, you what? You play confidently. It literally, yeah, you know, you go, yeah, this is common sense. But it's not necessarily common sense. Because as human beings, we've got these battles going on in every single one of us. Baseball players have battles going on inside every one of them as well. Okay? And you got the confidence side, you've got to win. Here's your infielders in the fear mode. Okay? Fear equals failure to me. Infielders who lack confidence operate in the fear realm. They experience uncertainty, doubt, and tension just a little bit. That's what I have. They're dominated by the voice of doubt. Okay? They get caught focusing on the did, what they did in the past, the error they made last inning, the strikeout that they made. You know, can I make the next play? Is the don't. Am I going to be able to make the play with the game on the line? They're thinking about these things that are going to happen out there and these things that already happened, instead of being right here where their feet are. Next pitch, next play, everything that we talk about all the time to our players, their mind is wandering and they're not on time. And we wonder why, okay? The space between 15 to 20 seconds for our brain is an eternity, okay? We're supposed to be processing the outs, the base runner, the score, you know, who's hitting, what the pitch is, all of these things, right, that we teach our players. And meanwhile, they're thinking about what they just did, okay, or what they don't want to have happen to them in the future, and they're not present, and then the balls hit at them, and they're not ready, okay? We got to understand this, okay? We got to operate now. Elite infielders, they don't take pitches off. They don't take pitches off, okay? They're ready every single pitch, and we talk about it all the time. Here's the beauty. We have control over our mind. This positive self-talk, I learned about it 30 years ago in college, you know, and I was like, no, I don't believe that, you know. But, you know, you really do feel what you think, and you do what you feel, okay? So if you feel confident, you're going to, you know, it's all about thinking confident. Who is the master? Who is the master of positive self-talk? Muhammad Ali. Okay, you guys are all old enough in here to know who he is, okay? I said my players are really, Muhammad who? You know, Muhammad Ali, okay? He would say over and over, I'm the greatest of all time, can't be beat. He 100% believed, okay? Now, you don't have to, we're not telling our players to run around verbally, talking confidently, out loud, but inside, you know, you got to get there. And you don't just get there by simply just talking it. You have to prepare in such a way that also allows you to have that true confidence. Muhammad Ali just didn't show up in the boxing ring with, you know, not preparing for months and months and months for that match. But he prepared in such a way that he truly knew he was the best and he couldn't be beat. Okay, and that's where we want to be with our infielders. Literally, they want the ball. This ball right here, this is the Glenn Academy, which, by the way, we are not a private school. Okay, I keep telling people, we're not a private school. Don't be fooled by the academy part. We're a public school, okay? This says IWTB. That's what I wrote on. I want the ball. Okay? I want the ball. This is one of our BP balls. On every single BP ball we have, I write something on the sweet spot. It took like 3 hours to do it, okay? For 15 dozen baseballs, okay? And I was like, you know, do I really want to do that? That's a lot of time and it's kind of dumb and maybe it's not dumb. But I wanted my guys, every time they pick up a baseball, okay, to go throw it or whatever, you know. A lot of them are the tools, the physical tools. I got, one will say throw tool, run tool. You know, I want them thinking about their tools, how they got to get better. Then we have, you know, the GDBRR, those words written out there, you know. Rat, am I being a rat today? You know, am I working harder than everybody else? So I want the ball. I want the ball, okay? That's where you want your infielders. Seventh game of the World Series, last out. Go ahead, run on third, it's tie ball game. Let's say we're ahead by one, runners on second and third, two outs, ground ball hitting you, you throw it away. Win a run scores, tie run, win a run scores. Do you really want the ball? Like, is it really the same ground ball that it was in the first game in a non-conference ground ball hit you? Yeah, it is, it's a ground ball. Okay, what you do, what you make of it in your mind, you allow the score, the circumstances, the people to make this ground ball seem more meaningful than any other ground ball you ever took. It's a ground ball. You field it and you throw it. If you prepare the right way every day, you want the ball. You want it. You live, I mean, Jack sat up here yesterday, stood up here and talked about it. You know, he wanted the ball. I wanted the ball. Okay? I wanted the ball. There's only like two times in my entire life that I didn't want the ball, okay? At once I got older, like into college, okay? And we're not, I don't have time to get into talking about those, but I wanted the ball, okay? Your best players, they want the ball. So we have a mantra, okay? Literally, okay, when we go, we meet now. My team, when we come on down to the field for practice, we meet outside the gate at our starting time. They're all there, and we do a get your mind right, you know, get your mind right talk. Not a talk, but a chant, okay? We have a mantra, so get your mind right. They don't say all these things, but separation amongst the elite, okay? The elite of the elite. That's what we're trying to be. It's time to eat. We've got to go to work. Fear nothing. Fear no one. We don't care who our opponents are. We're committing to the dude, which is what we have to do right now. Not the don't, okay? Not the did, but the do. And I'm the best fielder. I'm going to get you out. That's the mindset you got to carry. So literally, like, these things have to go through your mind. When you're a positive self-talk guy, you literally think this way. You think it internally in your brain. You say these things. Your mind starts to believe what you tell it. Okay? Man, if I, you know, I suck. I can't, you know, I can't believe I made that error. You know, like, this is brutal, you know. It's the last inning. Do you really want the ball? You know, no, that guy doesn't want the ball. Okay, three unknowns for every fielder. Is the ball coming to me every pitch? This is what the infielder's thinking. What kind of play will it be? So roller, backhand, glove side. Am I going to go back and fly ball? Will I make the play? If you have any doubt to those answers whatsoever, you are in fear mode. Okay? If you say, I think or I hope internally, I hope I can make that play. I think I can make that play. Okay? That is fear mode. Okay? And that's double-minded. You're caught in between. You guys were double-minded when I was doing that. You weren't committed to nothing. And then everybody kind of went half-hearted into what they were doing. That's what an infielder is double-minded, is playing like. Okay, so we got to keep them committed, because when you're committed to nothing, you accomplish nothing. Mentally weak infielders, here you go. Okay, they equal errors. I hope I can, I think I can. Confident infielders are the do. I want the ball. I want to move along here. We've talked about all this stuff. So literally, you're expecting a bullet every single pitch. My infielders are like, you know, the ball's coming to me. It's going to be hit, a rifle shot at me. I'm going to have to dive to my sides. They're never caught off guard at all when something's hit hard at them. Okay, they are ready to go. Okay, and they want the ball. Conquering the voice of doubt. Okay, it's a human response to have it. Stop listening to yourself. We talked about these. Okay, throughout the day or throughout the game, you listen to the voice of doubt. What's going to win the front of your mind? We talked about it already. Commit. Next pitch, next play. Expect and want the ball. Okay? I want to get to this. So this is a little example. Okay? Confidence and mental toughness, it's taught. So what I do with my players? Let them grade themselves. I talk about it. Help them understand. So they know where they are. And they know where they want to be. You practice it, okay? You practice it every day in practice. You remind them, you talk to them, you apply it to your drills. You can you create competitive situations, okay? They constantly have to execute positive self-talk. Everything that you're doing, you make them evaluate themselves after every practice in the categories, so they ultimately learn it, okay? They got to know it like they know their name, okay? It's not like, oh, I think they got to know it like they know their name. And then you have to earn it. Through trial and errors, okay? This is a little example. This is my son, Tabor, okay? He gets used in a lot of my stuff. He's like my little guinea pig. I just throw him on the videos, I throw him everywhere. You might go, well, you know, you're self-promoting your son. Not really. I mean, he's been doing it since he was 10 years old. Hey, I need you to do my drills, but you don't really know what you're doing. Like, Tabor does them every day, so hey, let's do them, you know, and he can execute them, okay? But when he was 12 years old, he was by far the smallest player on the team. This was the average size, okay? He was on AAA major team at 12 years old. He was the littlest guy on the team. But he hung in there every day, and I never let him quit. I never let him jump to another team. He played for a coach who I didn't want him playing for me. I wanted him playing for a tough coach. The coach was brutally tough, okay? Like, I wouldn't even recommend you put your sons or anybody with this coach. You know, but I had a goal, okay? I had a goal, and that goal was for him to get tough skin and learn how to compete his rear end off, because if he was going to play for dad one day and have to deal with all the crap that everybody was going to say about him, okay, he had to develop tough skin. So we move into high school. This is him embracing me twice. He never called me dad on the field. If you ask his teammates, they would say you would never know in a million years that he was my son. This is the end of one season. This is the end of another season. These two hugs are two totally different circumstances. He is crying like a little baby in this one, and he is crying happy tears here, okay? In 2016, Tabor made an error in the last inning. We were beating Locust Grove. We ended up winning the state championship in game three. We had to go out and hold them for a run. They ended up making an error and ended up costing us the ballgame. It was his junior year. Season over, seniors gone. He felt totally responsible for it. Played his ass off the whole year, made an error, cost us. Very next year, in the same round, in the Sweet 16, he had the same ground ball to end the game. I promise you, it was the same ground ball. The same ground ball. Almost identical, hops, location, everything. Made the play, finished the game. Okay, the rest is history. We go on, win the state championship. First one in school history, I got to win it with my son. So this could have defined him, right? He could have carried that with him, and he did carry it with him for weeks and months. Like, he couldn't let that go. But he worked and worked and worked and overcame it, okay? And here's the state championship trophy. It's actually him kissing it in the background behind it. This is in college. So he started as a freshman, started 48 games at the Division I level at 141 pounds at shortstop. Sophomore year, he's 10 games in, having a great start, breaks his thumb. Gets hit right here, shatters his thumb. Okay, diving into first, he didn't get hit. He was diving into first thumb. You know how we tell our players, don't dive into first when you're going? Well, that's what he did, broke his thumb. And it was devastating. We didn't know what was gonna happen, right? So he's going over, all these ups and downs in his life. So his coach leaves, he gets a medical redshirt, goes to the College of Central Florida, JUCO, and just this fall now he's committed to going to what he's always considered his dream school, which is UNC Wilmington. That's where he grew up, that's where I played, you know, that's where I met my wife, that's where he was born and raised for a while when I coached at Laney High School. So he's going home. So I thought it was a great, you get to see the journey, you know, and his confidence right now and belief in his abilities and his belief in God. He's playing at the ultimate level of confidence, but he will still have more adversity along the way. Okay, it's a journey of ups and downs. Here's the secret sauce. Okay, we always say there's no secret sauce. You got to know the mental game and believe that it's a separator, because it is. Wu Wei, you hear we talk about that. We do drills with that. You're going to see when we do the drill work, where we're actually working on this effortless effort, just making things look easy. Okay, playing relaxed, playing confident. Everything is free and easy. The best infielders, that's how they are. They make the difficult look easy. Okay, let the game come to you, the river. Guys that try to force things, you know, on defense, they get into trouble. They try to do more than they're capable of. Stay within your strengths, let your abilities flow through the game. Your intent, your body seeks to accomplish what the mind thinks. So when you think positive, you act positive, you perform positively, okay? The mind, the body will literally try to accomplish what you put your brain to. Okay, you guys knew you wanted to be coaches, right? You set your path in motion to become coaches, head coaches, assistant coaches. Maybe you want to move up, okay? Your body's going to try to accomplish in your life what you set your mind to every day. They know where confidence comes from, and they work to achieve it. Here is the separation, okay? This is where we're trying to be. I literally show this to my classes as well. This is the mass human race right here. Why is this so big? Average. Okay, these are all average people. The more you move towards here, okay, the more you become less average and you're going towards that 20 scale. Okay, 20, 50, 70, Hall of Famers, 2%. Okay, and I show my players this all the time. This is their goal, to be Hall of Fame. Okay, you can move to the right or to the left. Okay, just because you're here now doesn't mean you have to stay there. So what's your intent? Where do you want to go? Where do you evaluate yourself now? Where do you want to be? And how are we going to get there? So when they know the tools and they can evaluate themselves there, they know the six tools and they can evaluate themselves there. Okay, now they can start to work towards becoming an elite player instead of just trying to figure it all out on your own. So you got to speak your goals into existence. Okay. If you can't talk about your goals, if players can't talk, if they can't confidently say, "Coach, I want to be a starting shortstop, okay, this year," or "I want to play in college, I want to play at the Division I level, I want to be drafted," okay, if you can't confidently speak it, you're going to have trouble if you're not committed to what you want to become. The body seeks to do what the mind thinks. You have to think positive. Write your goals down. I literally did these, posted my goals in the bathroom mirror every day, where I had to see them every day. Okay? Over my bed. In high school, I had my goals on my ceiling when I was laying there. I know people probably thought that was weird. Okay? But in my locker, in my hat, sometimes I had certain goals in my hat so I would see them, and in your wallet. Okay? When you put your goals in your wallet, when you go to take that money out to spend on something that you shouldn't be spending your money on, okay, there's your goal smacking you right in the face, like, do you really want to do this right now? Okay, do you want to go buy this alcohol, marijuana, drugs? Do you want to, whatever, you know? How are you going to spend your time? So put it in the wallet. We're about, that's it, okay? So that's a lot of information. And you guys are probably going, you know, okay, that made sense. It didn't make sense. I like that little part. I didn't like that little part. That's cool. You get to do with it what you want to do with it. But I would highly, highly, highly recommend that you take the beginning part and you let your players grade themselves and start figuring out what this stuff is. What is makeup, really, anyways? They hear these terms all the time. We never define them for them. We thought, oh, he don't have makeup, you know, oh, he's got a bad character, or he's got good character, or he's got great makeup. They don't even really know what it is, half of them. Like, they can't even tell you. So help them understand that the way they think is extremely important, okay, and they will start to commit, okay? The drill that I did, throwing it up and letting the ball drop, is unbelievable, okay? For pitchers, when we talk about commit to the pitch, okay, that's the only pitch that matters. You commit. Adam Wainwright, I talk to him all the time about it. Okay? He talks about a commitment to his pitch. That's like the confidence you guys had right there. Boom. There he is, confident. Okay? You're ready to clap. Okay? We got to get the voices out of these guys. So, that is the end of that talk. Now we're going to go into the tools.